Welcome. Hello. Some of you may have been expecting to see Judy up here today, but unfortunately she's been feeling unwell. So she shared her outline and her prayers with me, and I have used them as inspiration for today's message. My name is Mary Ann, and I welcome you to today's service in Trinity United Church, whether you are here in person or worshiping online, live or at another time. We hope the words, music, and prayers will touch your heart and soul. For thousands of years, Indigenous people have walked on this land. Their relationship with the land is at the center of their lives and spirituality. As we come into worship, we recognize that Trinity United Church is located on the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, and Adirondack peoples who have cared for this land since time immemorial. The community of Ingersoll is represented by both the Between the Lakes Treaty of 1792 and the London Township Treaty of 1796. As we gather, we are mindful of the broken covenants and the need to strive to make right with our relations. As treaty people, we commit to listen, learn, and work toward justice and reconciliation. Hopefully you received an announcement sheet on your way in, and I see there's a little bonus on the back, so if you get bored, there's a word search. I see that the coffee time is not on here, but Leanne and Joe are hosting coffee time on Thursday mornings. If you need more information, see one of them. And they're hoping that lots more people will start to join them. So please consider that if it fits into your schedule. There are lots of meetings, and the annual reports are due for those people who are chair people. So make sure you take a peek at those announcements and note anything that refers specifically to you. We'll now prepare for worship with On This Path. We light the Christ candle, proclaiming Jesus the Christ light of the world, reminding us that the light and spirit of the Christ is always with us and among us, and will never be overcome. Join me in our call to worship. Among the poor, among the rich, among the persecuted, among the privileged,
Christ, the light of the world, calls us to walk in his way.
In the privacy of homes, in public places, in banquet halls, in soup kitchens,
Christ, the light of the world, calls us to work in unity for justice.
With a gentle touch, with a righteous word, with a burning love, with a challenging call.
Christ, the light of the world, calls us to follow him with love and courage.
that the kingdom might come, that the world might be saved.
Christ, the light of the world, unites us in common purpose and prayer. We are invited to come and see what Jesus is about. Let us worship.
We'll join together in prayer. Gracious God, you have called us to be a community of faith. Open our ears to the good news of your word. You have called us to be a community of love and hope. Open our hearts to the love found in and shared with one another, and to the one who offers us the hope of new life. Through your Son, you have invited us to come and see where you are staying. Open us this day and always to that path and place. Amen. We'll join together in God We Praise You for the morning. I see lots of children are up here, but if there's anybody else who wants to come forward, I'm sure we can squeeze you in somewhere. All right, so I have a bag of goodies. All right, so I'm going to hold up. Aww. You want to hold that one up? Joey's going to help me for a minute. So I have three items here. So I'm going to hold them up. This is a tackle bag. I think most of you can recognize this item. And Joey has a net. What do you think I'm inviting you to come do with me?
Fishing.
Excellent. That was a pretty easy one. All right. Let's see what else we have in here. All right, this one might not be nearly as much fun. We have a garbage bag, some rags, and some cleaner. Anybody want to come help me with something? What do you want to come help me with? What do you think, Brookston? No? No answer?
Cleaning, probably.
Yeah, absolutely. Anybody want to come clean my house with me? All right, one more. All right, what do you want to come do with me with these items? What do you think? Oh, Brookston knows this one.
Bake. Baseball.
Excellent, yes. All right, so some of these things I can do alone, like fishing, right? But if I join the fishing community, sometimes I can get some good tips where the best fish are. So that makes me part of that fishing community. Sometimes I need more people to be successful, like sports teams. It's really hard to play baseball by yourself. Even if I can do it myself, like cleaning, sometimes the job is easier if I have others to help me. As humans, we are made to be part of a family or community. What other teams or groups do you guys belong to? Does anybody have any sports or family clubs? Let's see.
Temptford Attack.
Okay, what is that? Is that hockey?
Hockey.
Hockey, excellent. Do you have one?
Temptford Attack Hockey.
Awesome. Anybody else have anything else they belong to?
I play for the Ingersoll Ironbirds.
Excellent, and we heard service clubs. Anybody else? Yeah. Horticultural Society, excellent.
Soccer.
Soccer, lots of fun. Anybody else belong to any communities? How many of you live in Ingersoll? Okay. Maybe some of you belong to a rural community. Right? We all are members of Trinity United Church. Right? So we all belong to lots of different communities. And we all play different roles in those communities. So we are also part of the Christian community. We are called to follow Jesus. Our scripture readings and message today, excuse me, are all about how Jesus calls us to come and see what being part of this community means. Pray with me by repeating my words. Thank you, Jesus, for my family. Thank you for my Trinity United Church community. Thank you for all the other little communities that I belong to. Help me to be a good member of your team. Amen. We will join in song.
My name.
First reading today comes from Isaiah chapter 49, verses 1 to 7. Hear now the word. Listen to me, you islands. Hear this, you distant nations. Before I was born, the Lord called me. From my mother's womb, he has spoken my name. He made my mouth like a sharpened sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He made me into a polished arrow and concealed me in his quiver. He said to me, "You are my servant, Israel, in whom I will display my splendor." But I said, "I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing at all. Yet what is due me is in the Lord's hand, and my reward is with my God." And now the Lord says, "He who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him and gather Israel to himself, for I am honored in the eyes of the Lord, and my God has been my strength." He says, "It's too small a thing for you to be my servant, to restore the tribes of Jacob and bring back those of Israel I have kept. I will also make you a light for the Gentiles, that my salvation may reach to the ends of the earth. This is what the Lord says, the Redeemer and Holy One of Israel, to him who was despised and abhorred by the nation, to the servant of the rulers. Kings will see you and stand up. Princes will see and bow down, because the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you." And our second reading is from John chapter 1, verses 29 to 42. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Look, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, 'A man who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel." Then John gave his testimony, "I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. And I myself do not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit.' I have seen and I testify that this is God's chosen one." The next day, John was there again and with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent that day with him. It was about 4 p.m. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two and heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah, that is Christ." And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas," when translated means Peter. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Have you ever been excluded from a group before? Maybe you weren't invited to the party, or you're the last one chosen for the team, or you didn't get that part in the play. The nice thing about Jesus' team is we are all called to play. In fact, God has a special role for each of us on his team, And all we need to do is follow him to see where we fit in that community. Come and see is what Jesus said to the two followers who would become disciples. He extends the same invitation to all of us. Jesus calls us to join his community. We are called to be his holy people, and we are given the tools we need to do the task. Our first reading told the story of how the prophet Isaiah felt the call so deep that he felt it before he was even born. The reading from John told the story of how John the Baptist brought Andrew and Simon into discipleship. I admire Isaiah's certainty of his role in Jesus' service. In my experience, it is often much harder to discern your call. We need to think about our gifts and how they can be used to glorify God. You don't lack any spiritual gifts. They're there, waiting to be explored and revealed. Verse 3 claims that the Lord told Isaiah that as his servant, Isaiah would display the Lord's splendor. Isaiah reminds us that we are representatives of Jesus, and we reflect his good works. Isaiah then goes on to claim that he has labored in vain, spent his strength in nothing at all, which to me is a reminder to put forth our efforts where God calls us to be. We may not see immediate results from our witness, but I have faith that God uses each tiny moment to build a foundation that will come to fruition in God's time, not mine. For me, it's easier to stand up here and talk to you than it is to discuss my faith with the non-believers in my family, who may ridicule me. But I know that both are important. My life, my actions, even more than my words, need to say, come and see Jesus. It's not about me. It is about pointing to Jesus' love, Jesus' gift of salvation, Jesus' faithfulness, Jesus' wisdom, Jesus' glory. Isaiah reminds us that God is our strength, and we can rely on him to show us a path that matches the gifts that we've been given. Isaiah's gift was one of speech, a mouth like a sharp sword, or in today's version, an arrow. It proclaimed the words given to him by God. Isaiah felt his call to the depth of his being, even from within the womb. The Lord called his name, and then he praises God for giving him the tools to do the task that God called him to do. However, like Isaiah, we were loved by God even before we were born, and in the womb, God gave us the gifts we would need to do the job he had planned for us. Finally, Isaiah acknowledges the challenge given to him. Don't just be a servant to your own people. Be a light to the Gentiles, so that the Lord's salvation may reach to the ends of the earth. We have the same challenge as Christians, to bring glory to God, blessing to God's people, and to draw others into community with God. Much of the book of Isaiah talks about restoring Israel to the glory, and yet, this verse reminds us that God's concerns did not end with Israel. They extended to outsiders all around the world. Our actions call out to others, come and see what Jesus can do. Come and see what gifts God has given to me that I can share with my community. And our community is not just those that are like us, but those that are different, those that some may see as outsiders. Many of the stories of Jesus show him interacting with people from all walks of life, including those that others would shun or devalue, lepers and those that were ill and disabled, women, including widows and prostitutes, the poor, tax collectors, and criminals. Even amongst his closest friends, the messengers for his word, the disciples, could be found tax collectors, political zealots, thieves, and those outside his cultural circle. Today's story shows two fishermen, a respectable but not influential profession, two ordinary guys doing ordinary work in biblical times. Simon and Andrew were called to be disciples, and Jesus used their gifts to further his ministry. In the past couple of weeks, we've learned more about John the Baptist and how he heard the voice of God telling him that Jesus was the one. And in today's reading, we hear the story again and see the ripple effect of the call to come and see. I can just imagine the scene, maybe a little bit like the Skit Brothers that you might have seen, the Skit Guys. You've seen some of those videos. John standing on the bank of the river with his fishing friends, talking over what they've been doing, how the baptisms are going, maybe how the fishing's doing. And all of a sudden, off in the distance, they see Jesus. So John stops and maybe taps Andrew on the shoulder. Hey, there's that guy I was talking about. You know, the one I've been told by God is the chosen one. I didn't know at first, but then God said, whoever the Spirit rests on is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit, not water like me, but the Holy Spirit of God. And the Spirit came down from heaven as a dove and remained on this guy. This is Jesus, the Lamb of God, God's chosen one. John was doing the task that God told him to do, baptizing with water to prepare people for Jesus. He was telling others that a more powerful one would be revealed by God. Twice in this short passage, he calls Jesus the Lamb of God, reminding us of how the Israelites and followers of God would sacrifice lambs as part of their atonement of sins, until Jesus offered himself as the ultimate sacrifice. John's disciples were led to see Jesus as God, and in turn, they began to follow Jesus. The first thing that Andrew did was share the good news with his brother Simon. In fact, Simon and Andrew became disciples. Jesus tells them, come and see, and then they in turn call others. It's a beautiful ripple effect. Jesus begins and calls us to join his community. He calls us to share the good news of his birth, as we did at Christmas, of his death and resurrection, as we will do at Easter, but also of all the wonderful things that he did and still does every day in between. We were created as beings of community. We can't do everything ourselves, but as a team, we have all the tools that we need to answer Jesus' call to come and see. Ask yourself what Jesus is calling you to come and see. What gifts do you have that you can share with the communities to which you belong? How can you contribute to the team? Recognize the wonderful talents and skills that God has given you. We invite others through our words and actions to follow Christ. We are called to serve, to respond, and to follow Jesus. Think about the United Church Creed that we recite together occasionally, and it serves as a call and mission for us. I'm going to go in through the parts, see if you recognize some of them. We are not alone. We live in God's world. It begins with that reminder that we are part of God's family, part of this community of faith, and part of the larger community of God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. John the Baptist testified that Jesus was the Lamb of God, a flesh and blood man who walked on this earth and was baptized in the water before beginning the mission that God had planned for him. It was the Spirit in the form of a dove that rested on Jesus and identified him as God's Son, and is the Spirit that we often call to move within us as we try to discern God's will. God created us, and God continues to help us grow into the being that God wants us to be. The Holy Spirit works in us and hopefully is reflected outwards to others who will see Jesus' love in our words and actions and come to believe in God themselves. We reflect Jesus' call to come and see. We trust in God. That is the fundamental truth that guides us as we answer Jesus' call to come and see. We have to trust that God will show us the path. We are called to be the church. Here's the call to come and see. Not only do we come to church to learn for ourselves, but we are representatives of Jesus and what church means to outsiders. Are we being good examples of what Jesus calls Christians to do and be? To celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. Just like the early disciples, we can point to Jesus and recognize the chosen one, celebrating that Jesus came to this earth to bring the Holy Spirit to all. We are tasked with caring for this earth, the people, the animals, the plants, the waters. Come and see the beautiful work that God has done and care for it. We are called to act as Jesus did, loving and helping others, even those who do not look or sound like us. Just like Isaiah, we are called to serve salvation to the ends of the earth. We are called to come and see fairness and eradicate unfairness. It is not our job to judge. That role belongs with God. But we can present Jesus as a symbol of hope. We are called to tell others to come and see that Jesus loves us, to show others that Jesus loves them. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Today, tomorrow, here, there, everywhere, and always, God loves us. By sharing our creed, we promise to share that love, just like Isaiah, John the Baptist, Andrew, Simon Peter, and all the disciples. Jesus invites us to come and see, and then go and share. Thanks be to God. Amen. Sharing who we are and what we have as people of faith is one way of answering God's call on our lives, and one way of inviting others to come and see the goodness and justice done in the name of Christ. The offering will now be received. Please join me in our offering prayer. Ever-present God, with this offering, we also bring ourselves and our ongoing commitment to come and see how you would have us walk in your way. Accept, bless, and use our gifts to invite others to come and see your vision of a worldwide community seeking good and justice for all. Amen. Take a few minutes to pass the peace. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Join me in prayer. Loving God, we praise you and thank you for your love for us, a love out of which you created all that is good, our homes, families, and friends, and the blessings of creation that are yours, ours, to enjoy and care for. A love that touches us in so many miraculous ways. Comfort in the midst of sorrow, laughter in the midst of the ordinary, a quiet center of renewal when we are running on empty, a love out of which you came to us in Jesus, calling us to come and see his loving, healing, challenging way as the way for us, a love out of which you came to us in the Spirit to enable us to be open to and caring of the needs of others. For these and all your gifts, we thank you. And yet we know, God, that too many are left out of your peace and justice, suffering the injustices of war, hatred, violence, and greed, suffering the sadness of exile living and natural disasters. We each have our own prayers. We pray for those suffering the anxiety of unemployment, hunger, unsuitable housing, and wealth inequalities. We also pray for those who are responsible for the injustices in our world, that their hearts be softened and eyes opened to your ways. We pray for those who are sad, lonely, or overwhelmed by complexities of living, for those grieving the loss of special people, and for those sick or in hospital, that your Spirit of healing bring them peace and comfort. We pray for our families and friends and all whose names and concerns we bring to you now in the silence of our hearts. Holy God, hear our prayers and in your love answer, for we bring them in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Will you come and find?
Let us go from this place and go into the world, eager to invite others, through our words and actions, to come and see the goodness and love of God. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forever. Amen.